Thanks everyone so much for coming today. Thanks BB for sponsoring this event on behalf of Sid and myself. Thanks for flying in from New York this morning. I'm glad you made it. I thought I'd start with this absolutely fabulous quote, which I love, from a few people, the editor of the New England Journal of Medicine, "In God we trust, all the rest need data." And the reason I love research and looking into cancer, and because of what we feel and think is often very different to the reality. So the stupidest cancer cell is far cleverer than the cleverest oncologist. And often it's the attention to detail that matters. So this Japanese picture isn't called the river, it's not called the house, it's not called the tree. It's called paired swallows because of these two little birds in the sky. And for all the congratulatory words, if you compare the death rates from cancer over the last century or 50 years compared to cardiovascular disease or infections, despite the fact we're living older, we're living longer, one in two people get cancer, we've actually failed miserably to reduce the death rate. Even though in the majority of cases, we can often turn cancer into a disease, as you know, that people live with as opposed to dying from. Because conventional oncology is characterized by poor response rates. So that means we can tell if something won't work, but we can't tell if something will work. I've just come this morning from a busy NHS clinic at Charing Cross Hospital. And I know that if I see a woman, as I did this morning, with a HER2-positive breast cancer, Herceptin, which you'll know, may or may not work. But if she's HER2-negative or her tumor lacks the HER2 protein, we know for sure that Herceptin won't work. So compared to other disciplines in medicine, such as pain relief or lowering someone's cholesterol, or treatment for osteoporosis or headaches, oncology actually has up until now fared very badly in terms of what we call predictability. And typically we've had an obsession with reductionism and understanding, and that we know the causes of so many cancers. We know so many cancers are caused by mutations in the KRAS oncogene, it's like the accelerator in a car, or mutations in the P53 tumor suppressor gene, which behaves like the brake in a car. So if the accelerator's pushed down or the brake doesn't work, the car's going to travel very quickly indeed. c-MYC, another oncogene, is often overexpressed in cancers for reasons we don't fully understand. And my laboratory described LMTK3, which seems to be new to humans from chimpanzees, perhaps explaining why humans develop common cancers, because our closest living relatives, chimpanzees, don't get common cancers like colon, breast, lung, or prostate tumors. And the derivation of this really dates back to July 1917 and the Third Battle of Ypres in the First World War, when the Germans used mustard gas on day one and the British used it the next day, and the survivors lost their hair, they had sore mouths, they were very tired. And fast forwarding to the Second World War, the Americans were very worried that the Germans would use mustard gas. So they had a ship, the USS John Harvey, parked in Bari Harbour in 1943 in Italy. Now you remember the Americans named their big bombs, Little Man, Fat Boy, Hiroshima, Nagasaki. These bombs were called MAR, like mother, 1 to 20, and they each contained 10 tons of mustard gas each. And the Luftwaffe dropped a bomb on board the USS John Harvey in 1943, and MAR 17 blew up, dousing all the Marines in mustard gas. Now, in the top right, Colonel Stuart Alexander, who is the American Surgeon General on board the USS John Harvey, noticed that the Marines dropped their white counts at day 5. And he thought, well, maybe there's something in mustard gas that inhibits cell division. So mustard gas became the very first chemotherapy. And these days, we don't really like to talk about chemotherapy, even though I prescribe it every day. We talk about personalization of treatment, treating the right person at the right time with the right tumor with the right drugs. But that's actually quite rare. Having imatinib in chronic myeloid leukemia, where one subway station derails the entire underground network, is actually the exception as opposed to the rule. Herceptin that I mentioned a minute ago is only applicable to 15 to 20% of breast cancers. And there are other drugs like that as well, as you know. But why is that? Why do simple treatments generally not work? Well, cancer's heterogeneous. There's no two cancer cells that are the same. In 1909, Ehrlich and Megnatov won the Nobel Prize for the Immunoscape Theory of Cancer. They said, we all develop tumors, but the immune system removes them. Often they're latent occult reservoirs, so you can kill the majority of a tumor, but you can leave one cell remaining, which can grow, and like compound interest, can simply lead to recurrence a year and a half later. Importantly, Stem cells can remain, behaving like a queen bee. They can repopulate the entire nest, as per paper in the New England Journal of Medicine a few weeks ago, showing that recurrence rates from breast cancer continue after 10 years up to 20 years, just like a queen bee. And beyond a certain age, our genomes no longer protect us. So why can't it be easier, like infection? Why is it that when we cut the heads off dandelions, they simply regrow again? This compares to other diseases. I mentioned chronic myeloid leukemia. The life expectancy now, if I was diagnosed with chronic myeloid leukemia today, for me, would be normal. The same as the situation with HIV, because we can remove the underlying immunosuppression, we can reconstitute the immune system, we can attack the viral causes, these drugs have a direct anti-tumor effect, and we understand that as individuals, as people, we respond differently. So this is Bella, who's a 28-year-old chimpanzee in London Zoo, and that's a sooty mangabe, another non-human primate. Now, when I was doing research into HIV and the immune system and the relationship with cancer, we realized a lot of individuals infected with HIV never developed AIDS. Sometimes we see cancer patients that never progress, even though we leave them alone. And we worked out how that happened in HIV. Now, I wanted to look to see if the same happened in Bella, so I went along to London Zoo to take some blood from her. And we put a sedative in her Coca-Cola. She took one sip of it and spat it out. We then put a sedative in some Ben & Jerry's ice cream, and she took one nibble of it, picked her excreta off the floor, packed it in the tub of Ben & Jerry's, and kindly gave it back to me. We've stolen the oncology ribbons on the left from the HIV world on the right. The issues in HIV are now, as you know, a problem of drug distribution and access, and a lot of oncology is going to become that way as well. In terms of going forwards, the drugs I prescribe today, for example, such as the chemotherapies, and two of those molecules on the right are chemotherapies, and two of those on the right are antiretrovirals used to eradicate HIV. And you can see, even looking at it from my point of view, it's actually difficult to work out which are the chemotherapies and which are the antiretrovirals. You can see actually the similarities, and those came about largely because of the war Nixon declared on cancer in 1971, when he wanted to test every compound for their anti-cancer effects. But when I look at a cell in the laboratory or in the clinic, and when I want to link the laboratory and the clinic, I don't know if the cell looks like this, which is the London Underground Tube Network, inside the cell. And the problem I have is I don't know if attacking Fulham Broadway, I'm a Chelsea fan, so I shouldn't say that, or Charing Cross is going to make a major difference, whether those are driver mutations that can derail the subway system or passenger mutations. But I don't actually know inside the cell whether it looks like this or this, which is my journey here today, which is why I was a bit late, or this, which is the new London roadmap, or this, which is actually the London Underground system drawn to geographic scale. And traditionally up till now, what we've done is we've taken a patient and we've sequenced their tumor, despite the fact their tumor can change all of the time. And we've matched individual targeted therapies to the patient. But now we're entering an era of immunology where the immune system is performing a biopsy of our tumors every second of the day. It's the ultimate in personalized therapy because it's our own immune system. And what we're finding is that the more dysregulated the cancer, such as the cancers on the far right, melanoma, lung squamous cancers, other cancers, and this y-axis is the number of mutations we see, the more likely people are to respond to immunotherapies. But you have to confirm this in lots of different models and lots of model systems. So now I'm going to hand you over to the star of the show, Sid Mukherjee, to go through that in a bit more detail.
Thanks, Justin. I wanted to talk about really something that's going through the world of cancer medicine in particular, and talk about how quickly we're changing our vision of success and why. And it begins, the story begins, as Justin pointed out, the story begins with the discovery of genetic mutations in cancer. This was the biggest story in cancer in the 1970s and 1980s. We realized that cancer is a disease, a genetic disease, and that genetic mutations in genes that generally control and integrate growth are what drives a cancer cell's growth and proliferation. And the analogy that was used by Justin was often used. It's as if you had a car or a machine where the brakes were snapped off or where the accelerator was jammed. And this car no longer has any control on its own cell division and therefore keeps dividing abnormally. And we knew that there were four or five ways that the brakes could be snapped off or the accelerator could be jammed. You could inherit mutations from your parents, BRCA1, BRCA2. So you could inherit them. These mutations would set up a propensity for the brakes to be jammed, broken and the accelerators to be jammed. You could unfortunately get the mutations because of carcinogens, tobacco smoke, x-rays, etc. That would be another way that you could get these, acquire these mutations. You could acquire the mutations randomly because of bad luck. When cells divide, when they make copies of themselves, like any copying machine, they can make errors. When you have an error-prone process, you can acquire a mutation. You could get the mutations from viruses, therefore some virally linked cancers. And there were a few smattering of other causes, but those were the four major categories of causes why you could acquire these mutations. And the field of oncology, looking historically, the field of oncology was simultaneously obsessed with this mutational paradigm. It was correct. This is the ultimate cause of cancer. But it also became a way of excluding other ways, physiological, organismal ways of looking at cancer. So our monomaniacal obsession with the driving mutations in cancer cells and our desire to create magic bullets against those mutational events, on one hand, led to the development of powerful new therapeutics like Gleevec or imatinib. These are small molecules drugs that would lodge themselves, someone said, like an arrow into the heart of an oncoprotein. This was a beautiful thing, it was widely celebrated. But it also was, I would claim, and this would be the provocative idea for today, it was also to some extent a simplification and a distraction. Because for a moment we forgot that the cause of cancer is an organismal disease. It occurs in the context of an entire organism. And that organism has an immune system, it has physiology, it has blood vessels, it has inflammatory axes, it has metabolism, and more we're discovering many, many other features of that organism. So I've called this talk Cancer's Environments, again, just to provoke the idea that cancer does not live in isolation like human beings. Cancers live within environments. And in fact, one of the most surprising things about oncology today is de-obsessing ourselves, decontaminating ourselves from our previous monomaniacal focus on cancers, oncogenes, and tumor suppressor genes. Those won't go away. There's a yin and yang quality about this. Those won't go away, but it's the what one might call the non-autonomous, the things that are not autonomous to the cancer cell, that has become one of the most interesting frontiers of therapy today. So I want to talk about that frontier. Okay, so just to go back to this idea, the previous model of cancer was simplistic in the following manner. You found a target, or you tried to find a target. We talked about BCR-ABL. You generally inhibited, or rarely you could activate that target, as I said, like an arrow, a small molecule launched like an arrow into the heart of a cancer-causing protein. And then you would kill the cell. I've added virus and bacterium because this model was drawn from the antibiotic revolution. Now, what do I do? Here we go. Was drawn from the antibiotic revolution. So in other words, this idea, you know, you'd have penicillin, it would go and attack something in a streptococcus, and then you'd kill the bacterium, and that was an infectious disease model. And of course, it was drawn from very powerful ideas about pharmacology. This is Paul Ehrlich, this is actually a drawing from Paul Ehrlich in which he talked about magic bullets, specific affinity, the idea that every cell, you can see these unique shaped blobs, one has two fingers, one of them has a single finger, and whether it's antibodies or antibiotics or various other small molecules, that you would go and attack the cell and thereby kill and transform kill and thereby cause all sorts of cures. So again, to go back to this, it was this kind of model in which you had a very linear or subtractive reductionist process to try to kill a cancer cell. But what we've been realizing in the last 10 odd years is an attempt to build from the bottom up rather than from the top down, and try to understand cancer physiology both in the clinic and in the laboratory, which uses a kind of somewhat reversed logic. So we build upwards, we try to understand, as Justin pointed out, not just genes, but gene networks that drive the growth or proliferation of a cancer cell. And they generally, when you look at these gene networks, they don't look linear like this. They look like real networks. It looks like as he pointed out, the map of the London Underground, where you can try to block one area or one node, and the entire network tries to bypass that, moves around it, and reactivates genes, thereby causing your one node to lead to rapid resistance and relapse. We've also realized that there's an integrator function here, and that integrator function is the cell. A cell, you can imagine, is an integrator of network information. It takes in its own context, it takes in its own metabolism, and then spits out, as it were, among other things, a desire to grow or not to grow. That's a very complex function. It's not a function that typically rides along one linear axis. Growth is far too important and too complex to be consigned to a single axis where you can generally inhibit it. And finally, moving up to the last level, that might be the organ or the environment level. In other words, where are the cancer cells growing? Why are they growing here and not growing elsewhere? What role does the immune system have in the surveillance of cancer? So I'll talk about this kind of model. This is going to be sort of my way of dividing up what we're doing that's different and new in moving forward on cancer. So these three things thereby lead to three new areas of human therapeutics. By new, I really again want to emphasize that there's a yin and yang quality about this. We're absolutely inheriting everything that we learned from the decades of using targeted molecular therapies like imatinib, like Herceptin, but we're complementing them with context. We're complementing them with an understanding of cancer's physiology. So we'll talk a little bit about genes and genomes, broadly speaking, instructions. We'll talk about cells, and that really is I'll liken that to the idea of a seed. But more importantly, and perhaps in a complementary way, I also want to talk about the soil. What grows and what doesn't grow. I'll go back to an astonishing observation that was made by a surgeon here, by Paget. If you have breast cancer and breast cancer metastasizes, it typically goes to the liver and not the spleen. Paget observed this. You find no, you can do an autopsy, you find no metastases in the spleen, you can find hundreds of metastases in the liver. And until Paget, no one had wondered why. These two organs live next to each other. Their blood supplies are very similar. Why is it that there's no metastases in one and not the other? And what's astonishing is, even today, we don't know. We have thousands of breast cancer models. We have tens of thousands of breast cancer trials. We still don't know. What about the soil of the spleen allows cancer not to grow there, whereas the liver does allow the cancer to grow there? Another example, again from Paget. It's even stranger. Actually, I didn't know this. After about 2 decades, I had to write a big piece for The New Yorker on seed and soil. I went back to Paget's paper, and Paget made the observation that when breast cancer metastasizes to the bone, it generally metastasizes to proximal bones, hips, shoulders, sometimes shoulder blades, but you never get a metastasis in your finger. You never get a metastasis in the distal parts of your bone. Why? We still don't know. Obviously, something about the nature of the physiology of that environment changes the way a cancer works. So let me focus first on genes, because I'll talk a little bit about what the relevance of this is with respect to the way we're thinking about cancer, then come to cells, and then finally come to environments. So very simple stuff first. Genes, most of you know genes are, they provide instructions to repair, build, and maintain humans. This is an important point that we've realized from contemporary genetics. There's rarely a mapping between one feature and one gene. There are some examples of this. Cystic fibrosis, a single gene mutation usually will cause a disease. BRCA1, single gene mutation in the context of, again, an organism will cause a disease. But most features, most of human features, are not the consequence of single genes. They integrate information from multiple genes. As I said, most commonly many genes instruct a feature at risk of disease. And the last point cannot be emphasized, that genes are a platform or a lens through which environmental influences and chance influences are overlaid on this platform. They're refracted through this lens, thereby producing the kinds of features that we have. This is, just for fun, a picture of Mendel's garden that people might be familiar with. This is the famous pea plot. This was Mendel's room over here. That's Mendel's room overlooking the pea plot. You can say that the revolution in molecular biology begins with a pea plot the size of about this half of this room. That's Mendel himself. So one way you can organize, so the question is, well, what do we do with genetic information today with respect to the clinical treatment of cancer, and what kind of medicine does that allow us to practice today? What kind of, and how does that change the way we imagine the growth of new industries around cancer medicine and cancer biology, oncology? What should we be looking for is the question. So one way you can think about this is you could use genes to identify people at risk, identify genes that are causing risk. I talked about some of them. Justin talked about some of them. The cancer-causing genes themselves, oncogenes, tumor suppressor genes, the brakes and the accelerators. You could quantify and identify the risk. So I could say to you, we have found in your tumor this particular genetic alteration. I suspect that that's driving the biology of your tumor. I'm going to try to block it with some particular medicine. But you could now do things that are much, much more complicated that you couldn't do before. And this gets into extraordinarily complex territory, which we're now entering. One is that if you could find the genes that identify the risk, you could actually find it in your unborn child. For instance, what will we do with the information around BRCA1? This is now becoming progressively a mutation you can discover. You know the family history, and the question is what you can do about it. Some people might elect not to have that child. And that is a complex moral decision. That's a complex ethical decision. I'll come back to that in a second. You can then use the gene to find an actionable target, just like we described before. And in some slightly more fantastical way, I won't talk a lot about it, you could change the gene itself, either in the cells of the body or potentially even in embryonic cells. I won't talk about the deep moral quandaries of all of this, because they're less immediate to what's happening in the cancer world, but I want to keep this in the back of our minds. I want to focus on this one, find the actionable target and find genes of risk. So here's a new kind of paradigm you can imagine in cancer. You can imagine a paradigm in which we use genes essentially not only as targets for chemotherapy, but we use genes to identify those people who are likely to develop cancer in the future, and then use that information in turn to try to figure out what to do about them. Do they go through increased surveillance? Do they undergo a prophylactic therapy like a mastectomy? Do they undergo a prophylactic immunological therapy? All of this is open to question. If they, in addition, have inflammation, should we be following those sites of inflammation? All of it open to question as we move further. And essentially, what we're doing is we're transiting in this moment from simple to complex genetics, because it's no longer the simple genetics that we used to have before. Again, I'm talking about the identification of risk. So in about a decade ago, our identification of risk was really focused on single genes. If you had the BRCA1 gene mutation, had the BRCA2 gene mutation in your family, you would be identified at higher risk, and thereby we would do a certain series of things. We could do prophylactic, we could give you a medicine to keep down the risk of breast cancer. But even within the breast cancer field, most of you know this very well, there are people who have strong, powerful family histories of breast cancer, but don't have the BRCA1 or BRCA2 gene mutation. Virtually everyone knows someone like this. So for those people, for those men and women, we would scratch our heads and say, well, I don't know what to do. I understand that there is a risk. Let's say, I'll give you a very practical example. A woman came to me, has a powerful history of, strong history, haunted history of breast cancer in her family. She has three daughters. And she asks me, and this is a real story, she asked me, can you help me quantify the risk in my three daughters? Because if I knew that Annabelle has the highest risk, whereas Lila has the lowest risk, I could tell them something about how to think about their futures, even before this, even before they manifest a disease. And I had to, as we still had to, we had to shrug our hands and say, we have no idea. I cannot tell you how to quantify the risk in these people, and I cannot tell you how to manage the risk. If I could, I would be so much more able to give them advice about what happens in the future. So that was because of the limitations of simple genetics. But now we're moving on from simple genetics to much more complex genetics, and that's the first idea that I wanted to point out here. And that is that, take something like height. So height is a classical example where it's a very highly inheritable feature. Tall parents tend to produce tall children, shorter parents tend to produce short children. Virtually everyone knows this. We've known this for decades and centuries, and yet, even though we've known that fact, geneticists have really struggled to understand the genetics of height. In fact, until about 10 years ago, even though we knew that height was very predictable in terms of, you know, again, tall children, we could not predict an individual's height based on genetic information alone. This was called the problem of missing heritability. We knew it existed because it had to exist, but we couldn't find the exact, and we couldn't build any kind of genetic model of height. So that is on the way of being solved. This is a paper that is still in preprint, but it's very exciting. This uses the UK Biobank, by the way. This uses the Open UK Biobank. Essentially what it does, I'm going to simplify it enormously. Imagine the UK Biobank as an enormous field, 500,000 odd members, in which the genetic information of an individual, say your genetic information, is cross-annotated with your features, biometric features and other features. These might include your height, your weight, whether you have early risk of cancer, early risk of cardiovascular disease, all of this information. And what we are now using is deep learning networks, what people commonly call AI, to try to go into this big information set and ask the question, can I attach connection weights to each of these genetic components that you have and predict your ultimate feature, your height, your bone density, your risk for cancer, etc. And this is the first attempt to do this for height, and it's actually quite successful. In fact, astonishingly successful. So this is the predicted height of an individual in this biobank. This is the actual height of an individual in this biobank. And just to give you one example, this is someone who has a predicted height of 170 centimeters. Their actual height is 170 odd centimeters. Now, I'm not sure if you find this impressive, but in fact, this is incredibly impressive. In other words, you can use the genome alone, no other information whatsoever, to predict an individual's a complex feature like height. And in fact, if you go back and ask the question, well, what allows this experiment to work? You need the following thing. You need deep learning. There is no way human beings, as far as we can tell, can't compute all of this information in real time and space. The architecture is extremely genetically complex for height, nearly 3,000 to 5,000 genes involved, but it seems that we're getting to the place that we can solve the missing heritability problem. Now, the relevance to disease, to cancer, to all diseases, well, we're already starting to do this with other complex diseases, so complex inheritable cancers. The woman with, not with BRCA1 and BRCA2, but what's been called BRCA3, women with complex family histories of cancer, men and women with complex histories of cancer, which we couldn't previously deconvolute, we're going to try to attempt to deconvolute if it's that heritable. And then, of course, it opens all sorts of moral quandaries. IQ is heritable, however you define it. I've written about it quite extensively. Skin color, also heritable. Whether we should go inside and start deconvoluting the genetic architecture of skin color is an extraordinarily complex question. Bone density is simpler, mental illness much more complex, and so forth. I'm telling you this because what this allows us to do is to do two things. One is that it allows us to quantify an individual's risk before that risk is actualized, thereby dividing the population up into various risk categories. You can imagine a world in which you essentially start off your life as someone with annotated risk. And the second thing it does is that it uses the same tools to ask the question, can you detect cancer in its earliest form using genetics in the blood? And this is an area which is truly exploding in technology. In other words, long before the cancer is actually manifest in the blood, particularly for people who have the higher risk, can you detect cancer in its earliest form, and can you deliver therapy in its earliest form? Again, a very complicated story, because we know that with previous attempts to do this, like the PSA, you can go terribly wrong. You can find lots of incidental cancers which don't become aggressive and won't kill you. And that's a big problem. So these are the two arenas where you can actually see the genetics of cancer turning out completely new ways of thinking. Okay, now on to the second level of organization, cells. As I said, cells are an integrator of genetic information. The problem with using cells as therapies, so we have used pills as therapies, we've used Herceptin, we've used imatinib, but now we're thinking about what if the cell was the unit of organization? What if we used cells, particularly the cells of the cancer's environment, as therapy? In the past, we had problems with cells. It was very technologically difficult to use, but now we are now getting to a place where human cells are amenable for transplantation. I'll give you one classic example of this. This is Emily Whitehead. She had BALL, a B-cell leukemia. What was done with that is that her immune cells were extracted out of her body, her T-cells were moved out of her body, genetically modified with the virus, thereby making them into killer cells for her leukemia, and then reinfused into her body, and thereby achieving a remission. So this is a full cycle of therapy in which you extract immune cells from an individual, T cells in this case, you genetically arm them using a receptor that'll attack her cancer cells, and then reinfuse those expanded cells back into the body, thereby using the cell, her own T cells, now genetically modified, as an example of therapy. We are doing this with other leukemic antigens as well. So back to the idea of using cells as therapeutics. Why does it work? Well, it works because we now are being able to find the right patients at the right time. We're able to manufacture these cells, often in extraordinary circumstances where we keep things sterile, grow cells to about 1 million to 2 million cells per individual, and then go on to give them the appropriate growth support, inhibition, and other things. And finally, we remove the ways that the cancer has to hide away from the immune system and from immune attacks, so-called microenvironmental inhibitors. And this could go on. What if we could grow organs? This is from 5 patients from our own clinic, where we have grown out individual organoids from the individual patients. This is a colon cancer that we grew out. This is another colon cancer. This is an ovarian cancer that we grew out. This is a normal intestinal organoid that we grew out from an individual patient. This is an embryonic cell that we grew out. And one of the things that we're being able to do is we can do functional testing. So in other words, take your tumor, grow it separately in a petri dish, test it against chemotherapies, and then ask the question, what chemotherapy will work on that particular tumor? What's incredible about that is that we use the cell as the integrator of information. Here's an example of what comes out of this data. This is several patients where we're classifying each of these individual patients in terms of a whole bunch of chemotherapies. About 200 odd chemotherapies are tested before they're even seen by the patient. Next slide. And then, just to finish up this whole arena, there are entire new worlds that we haven't even begun to scratch yet. What about metabolism? We know very little about human diets and cancer. It turns out it's an entire field. Next slide. The microbiome, a fleet of new papers appearing about how the immunological system crisscrosses information with the microbes that live within our body, the microenvironment, as I said, the immune environment, and the fourth, the macroenvironment. So these 4 M's are entirely new arenas of human investigation. Next slide. Again, major unknowns, what cells contribute to the microenvironment and which metabolic pathways are the Achilles heels for human cancers. Next slide. And part of the reason that we're excited about all of this is that now there are clinical trials that running across the world, which show that if you change the influence of the microenvironment, if you remove the cloaks, the immunological cloaks that cancers put around themselves, you can actually achieve enormous effect. Next slide. For instance, here's a pivotal trial published in the New England Journal of Medicine now about 3 to 4 years ago, which shows that the removal of immunological checkpoints, the immunological cloaks that cancers put around themselves, leads to a striking response and long-term survival of about 30 to 40 patients, 4 to 5 years down, with previously untreatable lung cancer. I had never thought that we would achieve a therapy for previously untreatable lung cancer, at least in my lifetime, but with immunological therapy, that's been achievable. Next slide. And so just a final couple of notes. Old idea, could we starve a tumor of its metabolic requirements? What nutrients are important? Are there bypass pathways? Going back to the idea of there being a network of possibilities in which you can find a nutrient therapy for cancer. Next slide. Some examples of this abound. Insulin is well known to be a feeder for of cancer cells. How do we manipulate something that's so central to our metabolism? Next slide. And early attempts at doing this in mouse models are still abounding. It's an incredible area of therapy to try to use diet as a way to modulate cancer therapy. Next slide. So I'm going to end here with some thoughts then about the future, about what we really don't know and we do know about cancer. Going back to the original idea, our so much of our of oncology was predicated on trying to understand mutational events in cancer. And it's very clear that those mutational events have led to new therapies. We talked about some of them, Herceptin, Gleevec, et cetera. But so much of what's new in cancer has to do with moving away from the mutational model and moving towards a model in which we try to reassess from bottom up what the physiology of the cancer cell looks like. Next slide. So rather than, as I said before, going from target to validation, to next slide, inhibition or activation, next, and to kill a cell, we're trying to move upwards to build up new models for therapeutics, going from genes that identify risk and allow early detection, potentially, to cells that are involved in the microenvironment that allow us to change the homes that the cancer cells build, including immune system, and to the micro and macro environment, which involve metabolic inputs into the cancer cell. And some examples of that are gene editing, gene changing in the genetic networks of cancer cells. Next, a very important role of immune engineering and transplantation, where you change the biology of the cancer. And finally, some fundamental questions about behavior, diet, and context that we didn't have before. So I'm going to turn over back to Justin to finish up, and he's going to talk more about sort of developing this idea through gene regulation. And finally, talk about how this impacts the development of new medicines. Thank you. You might have to tell them to help you.
So when it comes to gene regulation, you know, there's 3 billion letters of DNA that make up our mouth, our eyes, our breast, our lung cells. So what determines if a cell becomes a lung cell, or a lung stem cell, or a lung cancer cell, or a lung cancer stem cell, just for example? What determines that fate? Well, there's a lot of evidence now that the first molecules ever to form in a primeval soup at the beginning of life, 3.5 billion years ago, or maybe before that, were RNA molecules. They're very simple molecules. But yet, I often think that the molecules of life are lifeless, but life has a molecular basis. So when do you get molecules together and you get a living cell? And then when do you get living cells together and you can produce consciousness? But there are plenty of data that RNA, and we're not talking about messenger RNA that encodes a protein, we're talking about regulatory RNA that doesn't carry a protein code, it carries a genetic code. And these can be divided into short and long non-coding RNAs, very simple. But they have a multitude of functions in terms of that gene regulation and determining which way cells become fated, if you like. And we can actually use these molecules as new targets and to develop earlier diagnostics and to improve the lives of cancer patients using technologies that SID highlighted on like CRISPR, which I won't even begin to tell you what it stands for. And we'll get into the patent fight between the Broad and Berkeley UCSF. But we can actually use an enzyme called Cas9, which functions as a cruise missile, with a guide RNA next to it to localize at an individual nucleotide's level, changing of our individual DNA. And we can do that in embryos, raising huge moral and ethical questions. So in a paper I've got coming out in next month's Nature Communications, we knocked out a couple of these microRNAs, a couple of these non-coding RNAs in pancreatic cancer cells. And we put the pancreatic cells on a 2D dish. These are 2D models, not like the 3D models that Sid talked about with organoids. And you just get a knife and you scratch it down the middle. And there's pancreatic cancer cells there and pancreatic cancer cells there. And when you let go and let them divide, they close up very quickly. The cells just spread everywhere, and that's what happens inside people. But when you knock out these molecules using CRISPR technologies, cutting individual nucleotides, you can see that the cells don't want to move across the mark you've made in the plate. And the same for the other one. So you can start to think about how you can apply that to people and patients. And stem cells have the ability to form spheres in solution. Most cancer cells need a surface to hold onto. Cancer cells have, or stem cells have, self-renewal capacity, the ability to form spheres. And when you knock out these molecules, they don't form spheres either. And one of the keys to this, and this is what we're doing with NHS England with the 100,000 Genomes Project, is that we can link it again to the clinic by taking patients, for example, from Imperial who underwent surgery, waiting a little time so you know how well they did, and you can generate survival data. And we simply found high levels of both of those target microRNA molecules inside cells, the higher levels associated with reduced survival. And when you put these multiple models together, you start to realize what's important in cancer cells. Sid showed this, and just like the HIV story, where you're destroying the virus to give people a longer life expectancy, here you're not stimulating the immune system, you're inhibiting the inhibition of the immune system, or as Sid said, removing the cloak. And we've got good molecules that do this, but what's really incredible is that trying to make a doublet therapy, or even a triplet therapy, is proving very, very difficult. We don't know what molecules to combine with it, and people put out targets from LAG3, Kerr, TIM3. There's hundreds I could name, particularly if you can't sleep. I could go on like that. But we're struggling to get beyond these four molecules here, which are now used as our major checkpoint inhibitors in clinics, understanding that's the ultimate in personalized therapy. But patients are still dying of cancer. Take one per day as affordable. And when it comes to medicine, I love the fact that we've now got Erume's law, which is the inverse of Moore's law, where in Moore's law, we all know transistors are getting smaller, they're approaching the edge of Moore's law. But what we're finding in medicine is if you look at the number of drugs per billions of R&D spent approved by the FDA, it's getting smaller because we're getting what statisticians call a ceiling effect. We're already curing more than 90% of women with HER2-positive breast cancers. It's very difficult to build upon that. Although statisticians might argue that if you move that from 90 to 91%, you're saving 1 out of 10 people who would have died, which is 10%. So there's many ways to deal with the same statistics. Jay Flatley, who was the CEO of Illumina, said to me, there's an infinite demand for sequencing. I thought that's a strange thing to say, to use the word infinite in a sentence. But if you think about it, tumors and we, as well as people, change over time. So you can sequence people and things at multiple time points. And then if you're dealing with those 3 billion letters, there's problems not just of storing that information, because you can obtain it easy enough. And we're now talking about $1,000 genomes, but what's going to happen when we talk about $10 genomes? How do you analyze that information? A typical desktop computer can solve about 1 million calculations per second. So if you give it a traveling salesman problem, connect these 24 points on the London Underground system as closely as possible by road, that'll take a desktop computer approximately 3 billion years and 1 million calculations per second, just with a simple calculation like that, which is why we need neural networks or artificial intelligence, as Sid said. So in conclusion, it's not any one thing. It's not just about better surgery, hormonal therapy, immunotherapy, chemotherapy, radiotherapy. It's all of those things together improving our differences and making the cure rate better. Cellular and humoral immunotherapy are really major steps forward. If I look at the advances in medicine made in my career, they're generally very small, but immunotherapy is clearly a giant leap forward. We're finding new targets based on fundamental science, based on really what makes cells divide. This is not the sort of science that changes week in and week out. And in financial models, you know, funds are looking at a top-down and a bottom-up approach, complementing one another. Obviously, cost is a major factor when we're thinking of these developments. And, you know, I remember when I was doing my residency at Johns Hopkins, and I really struggled, maybe it's because I was born in this country, to work out that if someone walked into CVS or Duane Reade with $100 and bought some drugs, where that money went between the PBM, the retail pharmacy, the manufacturer, the distributor, the MCO, the insurer, and so on and so forth. It is a complex model. Jeff Bezos noticed that, trying to save costs, hopefully, in years to come. But if you look at his personal investments through Bezos Expeditions, it's generally in the field of longevity, genomics. He's building a 10,000-year clock in the desert to think about long-term thinking and how we can think about that going forwards. Overall, I'm very grateful for you for coming today and listening to Sid and myself, and it's a great pleasure speaking to you all. Thanks very much.